There's nothing more prevalent in today's world than what? Television. Television is everywhere. Okay, so let's look at television a little bit. It's very important. Now, it's not a bad thing in itself, actually, because what people are really doing or hoping for is they're hoping again to see, as in the previous video, I made the analogy of watching a movie that just goes on forever, and then having a tablet or a screen in front of you where you can then look and see the ending to this movie, a beautiful ending, so you don't have to keep on watching the movie. That is what people are hoping for with television, so that's why they're so addicted to it. They're hoping to see the happy ending. Instead of looking at this world. This world's been going on for billions and billions and billions and billions of years. Okay, billions, not hundreds of millions. Billions. Same old, same old, same old, same old dance of dust. Okay, it's a dance of dust. There is no happy ending to the dance of dust as it is dancing externally. So we need to see a happy ending that has been produced for us by the grace of God, actually. So the idea of looking at a screen, as it were, and seeing something different on that screen than what you'd seen out in the world is very compelling to people, super compelling. The problem is that there are those who know this and who are only in it for profit, for selling goods, for greed and profit. And they want to get you not a happy ending, but to say that buying this product or being involved in this issue, do this, this, or that, that provides you the happy ending, you see. So the programming you see on television does not provide the happy ending that you want. And yet here we're stuck with it, aren't we? We're stuck with it because we desperately know we need this and we long for it. Where's that? Where's our happy ending? And so everything is promoted to us like, hey, if you watch this, maybe that'll be the ending you want. It never is, but there's all these product placements, there's all these stylistic placements, there's all this very sophisticated stuff going on to really control you, to really control and do what those who have the money to produce the movies, etc., want you to do to enrich their lives, so they think that's their happy ending. In other words, to get, you know, incredibly powerful and rich in this world and say, see, that's my happy ending. So there are people in the world, many, who aren't aware of the grace of God, the happy ending the grace of God gives. So they're trying to manufacture a happy ending through obtaining power and control over other people. And they're using television, smartphones, tablets, all the multimedia and the news and the information. They're using all of that to try to produce a happy ending for themselves, all right, by gaining control like a puppet master over everything and everyone here. That is not the way that works. That is not the way that works. Now, one of my goals in life has always been to try to provide alternative programming to what's on the television. And I actually have enough videos to actually do that, to run 24/7. If there was some way to have a television channel, I have enough video where I could literally program 24/7 a very different type of programming that would help guide people towards the true vision of that the grace of God provides us, the happy ending the grace of God provides us. Now, the happy ending is not something we see on a screen, on your computer screen, on your tablet, on your smartphone, on your television or a movie screen or theater or anything. It's not something that is seen that way. It's seen by quote-unquote the mind's eye. It's a different type of perception. It's not the eyes that are seeing it, actually. It's a like a super senses that the happy ending is given, because in order for it to be a happy ending, it has to be seen properly, right? It has to seem to be invulnerable to not being seen. So the eyes being so vulnerable, you would say, wait, just the seeing of everything through the eyes and the senses gives a sense of fear and vulnerability and impermanence, right? It's not a happy ending. So nothing that is seen by the eyes or the senses, the touch, taste, smell, seeing, hearing, nothing will provide a happy ending that way. However, we can work on the continuity issue towards the happy ending, which in itself is the resolution to the continuity issue. We can get used to the idea through viewing something that is at least points in that direction a little bit. That is not engendering fear, that is not placing emphasis on bodies, most other persons, bodies, things, and all this stuff so much, but provides a general uplifting, inspirational experience. Sometimes very abstract. Like I put the last video, I put clouds, the time-lapse photography of clouds. This is something that is somewhat pointing in the right direction. When you watch that, it shows you, wow, this is a totally ephemeral dance that's going on all the time, and I'm not even aware of it. And this clicks in your mind. You say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe everything is this ephemeral dance. It's just at different time frames. The clouds move through in one day, you get all this dance. But like the plants here, if you were to take a time lapse over 10 years, you would see the ephemeralness of the plant, wouldn't you? Or the flowers over one season, you would see they grow, the flower, and you know, the ephemeralness of everything is really like clouds here. So at least you get that sense, hey, you know, it's pointing in the right direction. Other abstract stuff like bubbles that I've done, work with great spiritual teachers like Ananda Maima with her picture, doing all sorts of changes in her picture to give the sense of even the great gurus, it's all ephemeral, you see. Now, but uplifting and inspirational, like, wow, there's a different way to see. A different way to see is what I try to do in the graphics. It's like, let's see things very differently. Practicing that is helpful. It takes away a lot of the fear. I had a train of thought there, and I just sort of derailed it. So perhaps I will append some of these videos to the end of, like, these videos. We give a talk here, and then we need to, like, practice seeing something that is very, like, beautiful and different and amazing that we're not used to seeing. Okay, I'll get the train of thought back. Last night I had an epiphany, and I suddenly realized that the pure spaciousness in which everything is arising, all the dance of dust is arising, this ephemeral play of clouds, that pure spaciousness is exactly the same pure spaciousness as 4 billion years ago. And it will be the exact same spaciousness as 10 billion years in the future. It's the exact same spaciousness as right now. There's not the slightest difference whatsoever. It's the same. So when you're talking about eternal life, can you relate to eternal life? Yes, because the spacious, the pure spaciousness, not just the sky, that too is within the pure spaciousness, but it's like this pure, even sky-like super matrix that Longchenpa delineates for us so beautifully, points to. That's exactly the same now as it's ever been. So we can literally relate to that which has had everything arise in it that's ever arisen. We can relate to it right now because it's exactly the same. You might call that God, actually. And the capacity to relate to that is here right now. And I believe there are some that have actually have done that, that have been willing to just be aware of that quality, this pure spaciousness, and just abide with it. Like Ramana Maharshi said, abide with the self. He's talking, the self is this perfectly smooth, even super matrix of pure spaciousness, absence of anything as it. He simply was abiding in that, with that quality. See, that is literally available to all of us at all times. And this pure spacious, again, is exactly the same as it's always been and always will be. Eternal life, as it were. No change. Has not changed in the slightest bit. Exactly the same. Perfect sameness. This is a stunning when you recognize this. It's very stunning. And you say, wow, I'd like to relate to that. It's not a person, is it? It's not a place, is it? It's not a thing, is it? No. It's something else. But we can relate to that. We can abide with it. We can have it come into our living room and sit there, as it were, because it's already there, really. It's just we're not aware of it. So, no matter where we are, or what we're doing, whatever, we're not out of it. We're not forsaken. This quality, has not forsaken us. It's here, in pristine, immaculate, even smoothness, in utter purity, in utter spaciousness. It's right here, right now, with everything, omnipresent, omnipresent, omnipresent. That's why Longchenpa said, you're not going to find it far afield going and searching for that. It's right with you right now. Now but there are things to do that can be done to move closer to this acceptance. All right, that is possible. We're pragmatic here in the whole situation. We're not taking an absolute stand, absolute abstract stand. Only now. Once we recognize that the continuity problem is the only problem there is, that's it, there aren't any other problems, because the pure spaciousness is already here with everything. We're already abiding in it. We just need to accept this fact. And we don't accept it because of the continuity problem. Whim, which is what we engaged in when we wanted to be greater than this, than God, is the only problem whim generates is a continuity problem. But it does generate that. Very badly, as a matter of fact. It generates a horrible continuity problem, meaning that we're afraid to go from what whim is telling and showing us to what is actually true, because whim denies truth. So we're afraid to go from the denial of truth to embracing truth as it is directly. So that's called the continuity problem. We have this problem very badly, and so it has to be resolved. So allowing this pure spaciousness to just sit beside us, or sitting beside it, without foregoing our own perception at all, without foregoing that, is how the continuity problem gets resolved. Somehow our experience is overlaid by this quality, and yet we haven't completely abandoned any notion of all of perception. Okay. We still seem to be perceiving it. Ultimately, we realize that it's all been just all pure spaciousness from the very beginning. But that's beyond what we're aiming for. That's the highest, that's the end of all realizations and paths. It's the realization that no realization was ever needed. And because of the continuity issue, we cannot get there directly, pragmatically. We cannot. It's not pragmatically possible. So we don't need to obsess about trying to get there. We need to focus on the continuity issue. So, in doing so, we can take steps to bring us closer to accepting, to have a relationship with this pure spaciousness. To feel like, wow, I've got a friend, and it's not just a human. It's not a human friend. It's beyond that. It's not even a spiritual friend. It's this quality that's always been here. It's always omnipresent, and we can literally have a relationship with that just by simply quietly experiencing it and having our perception colored by that, like putting on rose-colored glasses. You see everything as rosy. By having a relationship with this pure spaciousness, this pure presence of pure spaciousness, we then realize that everything has this relationship. So we're still seeing all these things, but we realize, my God, everything also has a relationship with this pure spaciousness. It's fantastic. Oh my gosh, you know, everything is so completely blessed. Everything is so completely blessed. So it's a realization of this complete blessing. Everything's in a completely blessed condition. But you're still perceiving all these things. Okay, so how do we get there? Do we just talk? Possible. But it would seem to me that perceptually. Now, the TV watchers and those who control the programming of television, which, to be honest with you, are not, I'm always honest, but I mean to be blunt, let's say be blunt. I'm usually blunt too, but so it's redundancy to say to be blunt. What is happening in television is they're producing psychopaths. When you're watching television, you're being turned into a psychopath. And then, of course, psychopaths feel very, like, nervous, uncomfortable with that. And then they're told to buy this product, you know, to do this behavior, and that will help this condition. So they're kind of creating a condition that they then offer you the products to treat. Okay, it's very bad, actually. The programming on television is extraordinarily ill-suited to everyone. Again, those who are doing that, they're trying to write their own happy ending outside of the context of the grace of God, which is great arrogance, extreme spiritual pride. Okay, and they're going to have troubles, there's no question about it. But the presence of the pure spaciousness is with them too. They're completely blessed too. Keep that in mind. There's nobody that is not completely blessed. So, they keep hitting you with these special effects, this eye candy, all right? And we have this attraction to eye candy because we're looking for a happy ending, aren't we? So, if I attach something at the end of these videos, some eye candy, perhaps this will give you the fix, like, okay, I've got eye candy, I don't need to go to the television for eye candy, I don't need to go to the movies and all the special effects and all this kind of stuff. That's possible. I'm kind of like saying, I don't know. If that works or not. Too much of it, I've experienced having too much of it. I was watching all these very abstract bubbles and stuff, and it was a little, eventually, it got me too much. So you don't want to overdo it. You don't want to overdo it. So I haven't really posted these videos online. Some of them are, but they're private, because if you try to overdo it, it can cause a problem, I think. So maybe just a little bit at the end of a video would then give you an opportunity to at least stretch your perceptual boundaries without involving all this wicked programming that is designed to empower those with a happy ending that they think is the happy ending, which is not. The happy ending comes from the grace of God, comes from this relationship with this pure spaciousness that remains a perceptual relationship of seeing a blessing perceptually. That's the happy ending. That's the happy ending. And that cannot be depicted. It cannot be a contrivance. It cannot be a contrivance. So you can never literally see that on a television screen, or it's impossible. Because you seeing that everything is completely blessed is because you're feeling this pure spaciousness everywhere, all right? It's an experience. You can't get that from watching a screen, because if you're not feeling it, you're not feeling it. and there's nothing that can force you to feel it. And the important thing is that it's everywhere. Not just some things blessed, everything. That is the whole key to it. So if you are, so you can never be located in a place, the actual happy ending. However, a place can help bring that. Content that is pointing to it can help bring that. Talking, explaining can help bring that. But it can never be. It's all a contrivance. This is a contrivance. Everything you're viewing is a contrivance. It's not the actual happy ending at all. So let's get that very clear. It'll never be the happy ending. The happy ending truly is seeing the blessing everywhere. Every stone, every speck of dust, every atom, you know, nothing is separate from this ground of being the pure space of the super matrix. Nothing is separate from that at all. And never has been. And then perceiving this, perceiving and feeling at the same time, you perceive and you feel, I can see it in a spiritual way, I can see this is true. The question is, how do we actually get there? That is something that nobody's been able to delineate as a contrivance. Say this is exactly how you get there. There doesn't seem to be any one particular way that is, you can say, this is how you do it. So you can, ultimately, how you do it is your work ethic, is simply keep trying and keep trying and keep trying. Use every expedient that you can. Like, I've started taking time lapse of the sky every day. Okay, that's an expedient. It's just something that I willed myself to do. I said, you know, and just over a period of time, I kept trying, and gradually got up the courage to do it. You know, it was very difficult for some reason. Usually, it is difficult to actually get yourself to do anything. I went out and jogged this morning. Very difficult to do that, especially because it's freezing. I'm sure the rest of the country is, and many places in the world are just horribly cold now, but it's very unusually cold here in the Bay Area, to say the least, with a bitter cold wind, and three more days of that. So it's almost like a week of it, actually, of just this arctic conditions, it seems like. But I, you know, just did. I said, I just gotta do it. So if you have some sort of deadline, I'm always setting deadlines because it gives you a framework that doesn't seem to be forever, okay? And you say, well, okay, by this date, I've gotta have accomplished this much, have to. Make it very imperative and put yourself under pressure. Some people don't need that pressure, some people do. So not everybody is helped that way. So for me, the deadline is December 20th, because the 21st, 2013 is supposed to be a very significant date, actually. If you take the Mayan calendar, various calendars, it shows up 2013 more than 2012, actually. 2012 may have been a mistake. So the cycles, all these cycles are supposed to culminate in December 21st, 2013. So it's a very good date to say, let's aim for that date, okay, and let's keep our good habits up to that date. So if you thought you had to, like, run every day for the rest of your life, you might say forget it. But if you said, well, I just need to run for 3 weeks, maybe you can do that. If you just keep your good habits for 3 weeks, you know, you can do that, right? So that's why I kind of go month by month, really. It's too tough to just spread it out like, oh, 10 years, or year, 10 years, 20. No, it's too tough. You'll collapse and give up. So to be a trainer, to be a reassurer, which is what I'm functioning as, you have to set these goals and make them a little shorter. So we have this goal coming up by the 21st. I have goals for that. So try and keep your good habits going to at least through the 20th of December. When the 20th of December, on that day, you want to feel like you're really in sync with your good habits, and that you're focused on the basics. You get up in the morning and say, I got a continuity problem, big, huge continuity problem, and that's the only problem I have. Okay, and then that sets the framework for your day of where your thoughts are going to be. So it's super important to have a framework of where your attention and thoughts are going to be. Otherwise, the programming of this world, again, by those people who are not accepting of the grace of God, they're still driven by whim to so much that they're trying to find a happy ending through whim, okay? Through the means of whim, which means acquiring control over you, acquiring power and control over you, okay? That's their happy ending. They want to say, yes, I rule over all these people. They will pull your attention viciously, mercilessly, into their framework if you don't have your framework on the day. So you need to say, wait a minute. Again, the morning, say, well, the continuity problem is the only problem I have, and today is dedicated to the solving of that continuity problem. Now, A Course in Miracles is very good for those who use it. I don't happen to use it at this point, but at least it showed me the importance of dedicating each day. What it does as workbook lessons, and each day you dedicate the day to that. Now, I found it to be, you know, quite difficult, quite difficult. But It helped me get to the point where I'm at, where I dedicate each day to the continuity problem, because I see that's the only problem there is. Doing that, you control the framework of the day as far as your attention, not those who are trying to get a happy ending through controlling you. Okay? It's very important. Very important. So you don't get hooked into it so bad. Of course you're going to get hooked a little bit. There's a lot of fishing lines in there and they're trying to hook you. And you'll get snagged occasionally, but then you get off the snag. You say, I got snagged. Okay, now I'm off of it. Get right back. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. It puts beautiful blinders on you that are helpful. Keeps you focused, keeps you centered. And being centered right now is of extreme importance. Extreme importance. Because, again, those who reject the grace of God and are still caught up in the pride of whim, they want a happy ending their way, all right? And there's a lot of those, not only here on this planet, but on other planets as well. Now, we know that science has told us there's like 10 billion exoplanets or planets throughout this galaxy that could harbor life, that are in the happy zone like Earth. 10 billion. They also said there's very likely to be extraterrestrial life. They didn't say, you know, humanoid form or what form, but there's very likely. Now they've discovered at least 5 planets with water, okay? Just 5 that they know of. There could be, you know, a billion planets with water in this galaxy, all right? So, just do the math. For sure, there is water everywhere. I mean, water's just hydrogen and oxygen gas. I mean, the whole universe is made up of just gas. So, of course, there's water everywhere. H2O. 2 hydrogen and 1 oxygen makes water. And water provides the medium for all this, you know, peptides and amino acids and all these various things that go to work, this whole chemistry thing, dance of dust. So, all this information is coming out now, and you just realize that, wow, there's water everywhere in the universe. It's a water-based universe, really. It's everywhere. Not literally everywhere, but it's all over the place. It's like, oh my gosh, there's probably life forms all over, and there are. Some of these life forms are driven, well, the whole cause dance of dust is driven by whim. It's all the play of whim, which is denying what it is, which is denial of what is. But some have been able to turn away from that to some extent, towards grace, and some haven't. So there's a very big difference. And there are those extraterrestrials from other exoplanets that have figured out how to travel various places. And they certainly have traveled to this Earth, and it's, you know, they certainly want a happy ending for themselves. Everybody's looking for that happy ending because we're tired of this movie, okay? We're tired of the dance of dust. Everybody's tired of it. Everyone's tired of it. It's inherently tiresome from the very beginning, actually. So, but they want the ending their way. They want to be the architects of their own happy ending to this movie. And so they're very much into this they make blueprints of how to get the happy ending, and they're very much into imposing that upon everybody else, very much so. So this terrible imposition is coming not only from the people on this planet, it's coming from extraterrestrials of many different types, actually. There are many different types. Quite a few are visiting here and have visited. There's maybe some extraterrestrials which are trying to help free us from this. But they may be trying to free us so that we can help them with their happy ending. So the fact is that we have had great, great spiritual teachers on this planet, and we don't need to go to extraterrestrials to get the ultimate in spiritual teaching, because we've had it here. So if we pay attention to that, we say thank you very much, and but we're very well informed about it. And if you can be of help, that's fine. That's fine. If you want to pragmatically help us, that's fine. That's no problem. But we are well appraised of the highest teaching. We've had some absolutely stunningly great teachers here on this planet. Many, actually. And there's some that are famous and some that are not so well known. For instance, Lang Chenpa is not very well known outside, you know, the certain transmissions of Tibetan Buddhism, etc. But was an outstanding, brilliant, brilliant teacher. And there, Ananda Maima, Ramana Maharshi, just in our times, examples of a couple examples. And there are quite a few sprinkled throughout history. And some, you know, incredibly brilliant in telling us exactly the truth. And then, of course, we have Jesus, who's done a phenomenal job. So we're not like some backwater hicks just because we don't have technology to fly between different places. That's not the case, because that's not the happy ending at all. The happy ending is to see this blessing of the super matrix, pure spaciousness, to perceive it, that everything is blessed. That is the happy ending to this dance of dust. And that can be done anywhere, right here on this planet, right now, that can be done. It's not like we're lacking some sort of technology to do that, because all we have to do is accept this relationship that's already the case, and that's all that is required. In other words, the technology is already here, we already have it. Always have had it. Everything has the technology, the technique to do it, which is simply acceptance. So we're not inferior. No, there's no inferiorness at all, actually. But now, pragmatically, there might be something possible. But keep in mind again that there's a lot of whim that has derived a lot of hypothetical happy endings to keep us addicted to whim. A lot of different ones all over the universe. So just because, you know, it's not this one, you know, it might be that one. So how things play out in the future, we'll experience it. You know, one way or the other, we'll experience it. But it's important to keep the framework of the continuity problems. The only problem that I have, my salvation is entirely through grace. It's by literally perceiving, experiencing that everything is blessed, without exception, including ourselves. All appearances are blessed. All appearances are blessed. They always have been, always will be. Never a moment when they're not blessed. That's a fact. So you're just seeing fact. Seeing it, perceiving it. Ultimately, once we get very used to this perceiving, everything is blessed, always has been, always will, ultimately, we even drop the seeing of it, and it's just known. It's beyond anything we can conceptualize at all, so we don't need to worry about it. But we can perceive everything is blessed right now, right here, right now. So there's no difference. This ET, that ET, that person, this whatever, this world, that world, this galaxy, that galaxy, all the same. It's all arising in this pure, perfect, pure, even, smooth, super matrix of pure spaciousness, pure absence. It is all equally blessed forever. Always has been, always will be. So we don't need to attack anything. We don't need to get rid of anything. We don't need to. Now, pragmatically, pragmatism still has its place. But we don't need to obsess about what do I need to do, what do I need to do. Just keep on, continuity problem is the only problem I have. All this stuff like what do I do, how do I treat people, no, just back away from that. Just say, look, the continuity problem is the only problem I have. I'm seeing how that's resolved, and I'm staying focused on that. I'm staying centered on that. I'm not getting involved in all these philosophical, ethical, moral arguments, or political arguments, social arguments. I'm not getting involved in any of that, because I don't know what it's going to be like to see everything as blessed. But the great teachers have shown us what it's like, and they didn't go around solving all the problems of the world. They just told us, look, everything is already perfectly blessed, And so if you try to solve these problems, people will think, oh my gosh, there's something that's not blessed. You know, it somehow it interferes with the with this acceptance. It somehow interferes a bit. Pragmatically, occasionally, some things can be done, but there's a trade-off there. So it's something that you can only understand once you actually experience the blessing. So first thing, keep the blinders on, keep your framework intact. Continuity problem is the only problem I have, and the grace of God is the only solution to this. A happy ending is the only solution to it, and that is to see everything as equally blessed, as equally abiding in this pure, sky-like, smooth, even spaciousness, the ground of all reality. All appearances are all already arising in that, is experiencing that perceptually. And just keep on that track. Keep on that track. And try to fast track it. Try to fast track without too many stops. Of course, you're going to make a few stops. Most people make some stops. Don't stop too much, though. Try to stay on the fast track. That's enough for this. Now, whether I'll attach a video or not, I don't know. I'm kind of like, iffy on it. I don't know. It's like, wow. But we'll see. We'll see how it goes. All right. Very great. That's it for this one. Stay centered. Stay on track. Continuity problem is the only problem anyone has. That nobody else has any real problem except the continuity problem. And we know the direction to go to get the resolution to that.